I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you. Said I worship you, O Prince of Peace. That is what I long to do. That is what I long to do. I give you praise. Lord, you are my righteousness. I worship you. Almighty, mighty God, there is none like you. It's so easy to be in a meeting like this and not think worship is part of it. And Jacob said, I was in your presence, but I knew it not. And the Lord was in this place, and I was not aware of it. I don't want you to be in this meeting and be out of it. He said that those who would enter the temple by the north gate should exit by the south gate. And those who enter by the south gate should exit by the north gate. Indicating that nobody should leave his presence the same way they came in. That will be your story for this Harmattan Bible Seminar.
Oh, yes, Lord. Yes, Jesus.
And if you would take a moment to recognize that this is not just a seminar. It's an encounter with God himself.
Yes.
And as the prophet of the Lord comes onto the stage, you are going to encounter God like never before.
Yes.
So just lift up your hands and just tell him, Lord, I thirst for you. And I long to be in your presence. My soul will wait on you,
Jesus.
Father, draw me near, oh Jesus, draw me nearer to the beauty of your holiness. Sing it again, Lord, I thirst. I'm hungry for you. I thirst for you. And I long, Lord Jesus. And I long to be in your presence. My soul. I declare, I will wait on you, Almighty God, in the beauty of your holiness. I will worship you, Almighty God, in the beauty. beautiful.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. And your face is all I see. Your grace abounds to me.
It was Keith Green who wrote this song. Keith Green wrote this song. He said he wanted to write a love letter to the Lord. He didn't know God's postal address. Where will he post it to? So he put it in his Bible. These were the words of the letter. It's a kind of song that I like to sing because it speaks of the thing that's in my heart.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, Lord, you are beautiful. Verse is so beautiful. Oh Lord, please, please, in this conference, in this seminar, Lord, light the fire that once burned in our hearts. Light and clear, bright and clear. Replace the lamp. Your eyes are on this child. of song that is a twin to this song. It says, you are beautiful beyond description to marvelous for words, too wonderful like nothing, like nothing ever seen. Infinite wisdom, and who can fathom the depths of your love? You are beautiful beyond description, majesty enthroned above.
Atmosphere. Say, what an atmosphere. Hallelujah. It's a blessing and a privilege that we will gather here. Just few announcements. Make sure your phone is off or silent. Don't let it vibrate and disturb anybody. Number two, don't go on WhatsApp when Bishop is preaching. Tell your neighbor, you are the reason why the man is saying what he's saying. Tell him, you are the reason. You are the reason. Are you there? Going home. Number three, loitering is an offense at this campus. When program is going, there's no loitering. Nobody's allowed to be moving around. If you are, you want to, we should have done it earlier on. So just in a few hours, you also go and we again. So please hold your bladder. Do you understand? Whether number one or number two, want to do number one or number two, just keep it. Even number three, don't do number three. But whichever it is, make sure that everything is sane around you. Don't let it be any movement and moving around and all that of distractions and all that. Are we here? And then number four, don't come into the place without wearing a tag. You have come through the window if you are not wearing a tag. So the angel police will arrest you. Are we there? Well, this is the time we have been waiting for. Hallelujah. Now, let me ask a question, genuine question. How many of you have not, you know, this is called a seminar, but how many of us have not been to a camp with a bishop before? Not root camp, personally. Can I see by wave of hand? Wow. Wow. No, wave, so we can see well. Wave, we can see well. Whew. Well, today we are breaking that record in the name of Jesus. That curse is broken from today in Jesus' name. I say that curse is broken from today in Jesus' name. Amen. What a blessing to be here. What an honor to be here. Hallelujah. For those of us who are, wherever we are, the branch we come from, whether from Wale Wale or from Kaswa, we have had pastors who are caretakers. But we have come to your father today. Are you here today? Your pastor so far has been your caretaker. But today you are going to eat from the roots. I said, go to eat from the roots. Are you excited today? Well, I don't know about you, but for today, tomorrow, Thursday, and Friday, life transforming encounter. Give the Lord a shout. Hallelujah. We bless God that we are the feet of God to receive from the prophet God has given us. Amen. God gave us a prophet. God gave us a father to care for us, to speak into our lives. We heard him on podcasts. We have read his books. But today, he's here to speak to us live. Stand to your feet as you welcome the father God has given the UD. Give the Lord a shout.
Hallelujah. Wow. All right. Hallelujah. Wow. We are excited to be here today. Hamatan Bible Seminar. It's a blessing. Heavenly Father, we thank you for making today possible as we come before your holy word in this time. We ask that you guide us and bless us with your mighty spirit speaking, revealing to us your beautiful will. We are grateful, dear Lord, for this great opportunity. Lead us by your angel, by your spirit, by your light into your perfect will. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Wonderful. You are all welcome to the first session of our Hamatan Bible Seminar. I used to attend Winter Bible Seminar, Kenneth Hagin's Winter Bible Seminar, so I felt, why not have a Hamatan Bible Seminar? Some of you have not yet learned and believe in the art of copying and following. But it works for some of us. The more we copy things, the more things work. I pray for you to be humble to learn that. Amen. Well, in this time, I hope that your hearts will be ready to receive the message and the messages that we have. The theme for our seminar is make yourselves saviors of men. Make yourself saviors of men. Now, these words are the words of William Booth. Have you heard of William Booth? William Booth was the founder of the four, the Salvation Army ministry, and he was encouraging his followers, and he told them, make yourselves saviors of men. All right? So that is the theme. Make yourself saviors of men. Now, another way you can put it is obey the Great Commission. The Great Commission. The Great Commission is what we all know in the Bible as what Jesus taught us. Go into all the world and preach the gospel. You can find that in Matthew 28 and verse 19. Let's read from verse 18. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. All right? All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Verse 19. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. All right? And the next verse, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. Lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. Amen. Now, these are last words of Jesus. And last words are usually feared words, words that are respected by whoever hears them. I remember one of our pastors died, and when he died, I think he came from a royal family, or I don't know, something special. He was from somewhere special. And as soon as he died, they came for the body and took him away to the special place that they have for that family. And they were going to bury him at a special place also. So everything was special. So, his son happened to be with him either the day he died or the day before he died. And in his weak voice, he said, when I die, his voice was trembling. He said, when I die, my body should be put in the lighthouse hospital mortuary, because we have an executive mortuary, nicer than all the mortuaries in Accra. Oh yes, it's very executive. Nobody will see you when you are there. If you go to the public place, a lot of people will see you that shouldn't see you. So, and then he said, my body should be given to Bishop Hayward Mills. And whatever they decide should be done. But his voice was trembling. My body should be given to Bishop. When the son took the tape to the people and played it to those special people, I don't know exactly what they were, but they were special. Royal, whatever. When they heard the words, they said, come for. They feared. Because last words are fearful words. And last words, if you know what is good for you, you have to respect them. Are you listening to me? So, Jesus Christ had his last words, and these words were, go ye therefore into all nations and teach my word and baptize people in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Verse 20, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. Now, if you've been in the church for some time, you know, you will see a lot of needs. You know, there are a lot of problems and a lot of things that we need. We need money, especially. We need cars. We need transport. We need jobs. We need food. We need to travel. We need visas. We need tickets. We need school fees. We need university fees. We need admission. We need to be pregnant. We need to give birth. We have so many things that we need. Huh? Yes. These are needs. And when you are a pastor and you care for people, when you stand in front of the people and you see the people with their needs, I tell you, if you don't take care, which a lot of people haven't taken care, you would put aside this great commission and try to solve the great needs that you can see with your eyes. That these are problems that are really pinching people. Real issues. You get it? It's not made up issues. Real things that are worrying people. And this thing about going into the world and preach the gospel, it looks almost theoretical and ethereal. You get it? Something that even you wonder whether it is necessary. So, if you don't take care, you will never obey the Great Commission. You will not do it. Now, instead of obeying the Great Commission, you may not obey the Great Commission and you do something else. You have another commission. Now, what's going to happen is what happens in Matthew 28 and verse 20. He said, teaching them to observe all things whatever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always. Which means The presence of God will be with you when you keep the Great Commission and you do His work and you preach the gospel. Now, when you do not preach the gospel and you do not fulfill the Great Commission, no matter how clever your message is, it says, "Lo, I am with you." So then you see that you lose His presence with you. You lose His presence. Yes, you lose His presence. "Lo, I am with you, even to the end of the world." How many want to lose His presence? Now, many churches have lost the presence of God. Yes. Many churches have lost the presence of God. This morning, I was in my house, and then I heard, I don't know whether it was a church or music. I don't think it was a church. What day is today? Tuesday. I don't think it was a church. But I heard hymns being sung. I don't know if it was a radio, but it sounded like a church service. People were singing. And immediately, I felt or thought of a funeral. I thought of a funeral. Do you see? Then when I came to where my wife was, she was also singing a hymn. So I told her that, look, these hymns, they are almost negative to me because I grew up with fake Christianity embellished with hymns. I never knew Christ. We were singing hymns all the time. I didn't know Jesus. And I was in it like that, on my way to hell. And the main time that we heard these hymns were when there was a funeral. So as soon as you start singing certain hymns, I think of a funeral and a certain type of church with a funeral. Which is not a good thing, because Jesus sang hymns. The Bible says they sang hymns. And Paul said we should speak to one another in psalms, spiritual songs, and hymns. So hymns are good things. But that thing was associated with a Christianity that had no Christ. So it's almost like, you know, you form a song. You know that then sometimes there are some songs, when you hear, it reminds you of something. Yes. If, for instance, somebody dies and you like some music, don't play music around that time, somebody dear to you, because you will like that music after. When that music is played, to remind you of that time. So you should put away that one till later, lest you associate the pain of that experience with that particular music. Yes. As some of you, when you hear certain songs, it reminds you of some relationships you had. Yes. Certain old days. But it depends. And I'm saying that those hymns have that unfortunate effect on me. I had a friend, one of my friends from Commonwealth Hall, when he first came to the church, we were singing praises. He cannot sing because he sang a profane version of it. So when the song comes, he cannot sing. He said, no. The words that are in my head are too wild. So he never sang the praises. Now, when you preach the gospel, you guarantee yourself that the presence of God is there. And where the presence of God is, how do we know that the presence of God is there? Well, You can't say one particular thing. The presence of God is like the presence of a person. So the things that come with the person, most of all, an aura or a feeling that the person is around. You will not know these things till somebody dies. If somebody dies, you understand what I'm talking about. So that's the first one. It's like there's an aura that the person is there, is around. Then the second is the person's voice. If you are alive and you are in your house, when you speak, the people will hear. The people will shout, Kofi, Kwame. You get your voice. The third is the one that may or may not be there, but is also commonly there, is the gifts that the person or the things the person has. You can do. If your father is dead, the school fees, the money, the whatever that he would have given, unfortunately, it is not going to be coming. Because he is not there. So when the Holy Spirit or God's Spirit is present, then a lot of the things that are his gifts, like his wisdom, his word of knowledge, discerning of spirits, the healings, working of miracles, which is dunamis, working of power, just power. Working on miracles is not healing, it's power. The word, you can check it. The word miracle is power, dunamis. So just power things is a manifestation. Just power, working of power, working of dunamis. So power feelings. Benny Hinn is very famous for that. The working of power, working out of power. And then, speaking in tongues. In America today, many charismatic churches, they do not have speaking in tongues in the church. They don't speak in tongues in the church. Charismatic, the modern Christian churches, is something that feel it will not let. You can pray at home. They believe in praying in tongues, but not in the church service. I know somebody who just came from a conference where they had all the American pastors and so on. They discussed this, they don't have that. And so on. Amazing. So when a person's presence is no more, they said, Lo, I am with you. And then his provision, what he provides, his money, provision, his gifts. Yeah. If somebody powerful is around, he may give you a gift, he may give you a car. He may even give you money. He may give you other valuable things. He may take you somewhere. All those things go with the presence. All those things go away when we don't preach the gospel. All those things go. That is why the largest group of beggars are the church. Begging for money always. Yeah. The largest group of beggars is the church. Begging for money always. Needing money always. Never having money. So the church must be careful with the last words of Jesus Christ, because it goes with the promise of his presence. Amen. Now, turn with me to Galatians chapter 1. In Galatians chapter 1, Paul doesn't take long to start going deep. Verse 6. He said, I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. He says, I'm surprised that it has been so fast. Eh? That you are so soon removed from him who called you into the grace of Christ and to another gospel. Now, what is another gospel? Let's look at verse 7. Which is not another. But there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. So again, you see, he says that an alternative message has been brought in. And today, the alternative message is, have a good life, a good time, prosper, be happy. God is going to bless you no matter who you are and no matter what you do. Come and take it now. Receive your blessings. Mm-hmm. We are good at it. Yes. And here we go into another gospel, the gospel of happiness, the gospel of a good life, the gospel of security, the gospel of osmosis. Do you know what is osmosis? What is osmosis? Molecules moving from a region of high concentration, low concentration, to high concentration through a semi-permeable membrane. Low to high, isn't it? High solvent, but low concentration. High concentration to low concentration is diffusion. You knew it, Joseph. So, we sort of feel that just as particles just move, and you see, we are low concentration in the world. The world is out with high concentration. And it's like salvation is going to move from a few of us to where there are many. That's osmosis. Yes. But you see, it does not happen that way. Another gospel of whatever, that is not the gospel. And it's a perversion of the gospel. So the gospel is the gospel. God so loved the world. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1. I want you to see the gospel. Paul just summarized it a bit there. I like it. Moreover, brethren, I declare the gospel that I preach to you. I declare the gospel that I preach you, which you have received, wherein you stand. Okay? The next verse. By which you are also saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. So you have to keep it in your memory. This is one of the few verses in the Bible where the word memory is used. Memory. Keep in memory. Okay? Paul is just summarizing what he preaches. Verse 3. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how Christ died for our sins according to the scripture. Yes. Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. Verse 4. And that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. This is what I came to preach to you. Verse 5. And that he was seen of Cephas and then of the 12. He rose from the dead and he was seen of all these people. The next one, verses, yeah. And that after that he was seen by 500 people at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present day, but some have fallen asleep. So it's a summary. Let's go back to verse 1. He says, my brethren, I declare to you the gospel that I preach. So when we say the gospel, we have to know what we are talking about. What's the gospel we are talking about? Which you also heard, wherein I stand. Verse 2. By which you are also saved. You know how you got saved is what I was talking about. If you can keep in memory what I preached to you. If you can kindly remember what I preached to you. Unless you believe in vain. Verse 3. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received. Which is, I told you what I first received. That Christ died for our sins. So that's Jesus Christ came to this world, died for our sins according to the scripture. Verse 4. That he was buried, that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. Verse 5. And he was seen by Peter and then of the 12 and then the rest of us. That's all. That's the gospel. So he says, I heard some people have another gospel. A gospel of economic empowerment. A gospel of marketplace economics. A gospel of vocational enhancement. Yes. And all these so-called empowerment things, you know, plus motivational speaking and speeches, none of these are the gospel that we are talking about. And when you don't preach the gospel, for whatever reason, there are many reasons why, you lose the presence of God. And if you are sensitive, I gave you three things. Just the aura. You go to a house and the person is he around? He's around. You sort of feel that he's around even though you don't see him. Is the man there? He's there. Oh, okay. His car is there, so he's around. Number two, his voice. Hey, who is that? Who is outside? That's daddy. And number three, his gifts or his provisions, the things that he has. You get it? All these show that the person is around. Yes. When you are far from him, these things are not there. His voice, he doesn't speak. The presence of God is not sensed and felt. And then the gifts of God, the power of God, the provisions of God are absent. Yeah, because he's not around. That's why you see children of a man who was rich, when the man is gone, they struggle. Because the presence of the person is not there. So that makes them struggle. That is why when we go for a funeral of someone who had small children, people are mostly thinking about the children because of the gifts and provisions that the man would have helped the children with to grow up. Immature people are not so much thinking of the wife who may have been quarreling anyway before things ended. Are you listening to me? Yes. So, this presence is something we cannot lose. Now, back to Galatians chapter 1. He said, I'm surprised that very soon, like this, you have moved away to another gospel. In verse 7, I'm surprised. And there are some people who want to change the gospel of Jesus Christ. And again, I told you, when you stand in front of people and you are a genuine pastor, you will feel the need to talk about what the problems are. Verse 8. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel, whether it's empowerment, whether it's motivational, whether it is success gospel, whether it's money gospel, whether it is happiness, good life gospel, whether it's no heaven, no hell gospel, let that person, I didn't write the Bible, be accursed. This is actually something missing from my book on how to neutralize curses, which is the curse of Paul. Yes. It's the curse on those who shift from the gospel. It's the curse of Paul. If anyone, anybody who comes to preach a different gospel, let him be accursed. So there is a curse. It's missing from my book. The curse of Paul. For those who change the gospel of Jesus Christ into gospel of doing well in life and human positivity, prosperity, and all these other things, we dominate preaching today. Let him be accursed. Verse 9. Now, as we said before, so I say again, I want to repeat it so that you know by the word of two or more, it's established. If any man, preach any other gospel unto you than that which you have received, let him be accursed. Is it the same verse as verse 8? Look at verse 8. Verse 8 is cursed. And verse 9 also cursed. The curse of Paul. Yes. So, it's a wazabanga. All right? So the gospel of Jesus Christ, you can understand why people are not prospering. Yes. Why people are not becoming millionaires. And why people are not able to do what they thought they could do with life. And it is because the gospel set aside, you get it, is to bring yourself out of the presence of God into straight, into the open jaws of a curse. Now, curses are simple things. Frustrations, defeat, sickness, disease, unhappiness, lack, especially in the midst of plenty. When I say lack in the midst of plenty, like there is plenty of everything, but we still don't have. That's what I mean by the curse. Yes. They are simple frustrations. Amazing frustrations. So brothers and sisters, you don't have to look far to find a curse. You don't have to look far. Huh? All around, we can see the needs, the frustrations. Do you know Ghana is covered with gold? and oil. We could also be called the oil coast or the gold coast, or any of these names would be true. Yes. The oil they found is more than all the one that they found already that we said we found oil. They found more. And there is oil in Bwipe, Tamale, the Volta Lake, the north, all over. We are covered.
And yet we have my nothing that missing.
Now, that is what we mean when you say something is a lot, but when you are in it, you don't eat it. Yes. So, for me, I think it is important that we keep on preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. I think that it's very important. I don't think that, you know, if you ask me naturally what the people need, I won't preach gospel. No, I have so many things, especially marriage. I can have a lot of new teachings and new ideas about marriage. Yes. Yes. That can reduce the divorce rate. Right now, half of all adult Christian adults are divorced. Well, not in Ghana, I think, but across the world. Even in Ghana, half. The same as the world. But among Jews, it's 10%. Wow. Yes. Among Jews, it's 10%. There's a secret. I could tell you, but these are not the topic that I want to share the secret. Yeah. Among Jews, it's just 10%. Yeah. Amazing. I'm sure you'd like to know what the secret is. It's a need we have. Amen. So, I want us to beware of what it means to preach the gospel. Now, one of the ways you can make sure that you preach the gospel is by not becoming a preacher of anything else. Especially, what is the big bulk of what you preach? You see, when we say what you preach, it's like, what's the main theme of what is being preached? That's what you are preaching. So the main thing for many people, the main thing, like the big part, is something else apart from the word of God. It's all the things we need forms a large part of our message. And I'm saying to you that one of the ways to ensure that you don't swerve off is to make sure that you are preaching 70%, 80% of these main things. Prosperity, happiness, marriage, good children, all that. It's a small percentage of it. Now, when I got saved, you know, I went to a school, a church school, but I wasn't saved in the school. So, I went to church hospitals, church schools. None of them gave me salvation. One of the denominations in the country. Very good schools, very good hospitals. I mean, thank God for the blessing they have been to the nation. So when I got saved, I was hurt. I was offended with those churches because I never found Christ. But I found education. And I found hospital, but I didn't find Jesus. So I realized that the church had become 70 to 80% an NGO or a humanitarian organization. It's another gospel. and the presence of God is told, and I was a sinner on my way to hell. And you would think that many of these denominations have changed their ways, but they have not changed their ways. If you attend a funeral there, you see that it's the same thing as it was. Because I recently attended a funeral, I was shocked that I thought they have stopped all these things. But I tell you, we need the presence of God and the power of God and the help of God. And we don't need any extra curses apart from the ones that are already in the system. So let it be that the mainstay of all that we are doing becomes the gospel. Jesus Christ, he's crucified. He died for people. People must know the Lord. People must change. Religion is not the same as Christianity. You must be born again. That's how you got saved. And that's how people get saved. And that's the kind of message people need to hear so that they get saved. That is the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's how I got saved. Through scripture union. Yes. That message will keep us, I tell you, and it will keep his presence with us. It will keep the blessing of God with us. It will save us from the curse that is roaming all over the place, I tell you. So, I want us to make, follow what William Booth said. Today, if you see the Salvation Army, you hardly hear of Christ being preached. They are a blessing in terms of clothes, humanitarian work, and so on. And you see that it loses its relevance. Yes. It loses its relevance. I mean, something else has taken over. There's death. And there's a curse. And he says, Lord, I'll be with you. And he's not there anymore. You cannot replace the message. You see, Jesus died on the cross. Look, if Jesus died on one of the hills here in Mampong, right, how will the people in America know? It's only those who study Ghanaian history will know that a man called Jesus Christ died on a hill here in Mampong. So are you saying that only history students and those history students who study Jewish history, like Josephus, who was born just about 4 or 5 years after Christ died. He was now born. Who wrote the history of the Jews? Such few people who study Jewish history would know about Jesus dying on the cross. Few people will ever know. So if you don't have propagators and repeaters of the same story to repeat this story over and over and over and over again, this message and this salvation will not go to anywhere. It will just be ending where Jesus died. And Jesus cannot go himself to teach, to preach about himself. Yes. He cannot go. He cannot go. It's a historical fact that he died on the cross. It's only left for history students. And in history, you know, my daughter is doing history. So I said, which history are you doing? They have this history, history of Europe, history of this, history of that, history of Ghana, history of Africa, history of, and even the history, they have Cold War, before the Cold War, then they have 17th century. I mean, there's so many compartments of history. So if now you, Jewish history, you have to even start from which part of Jewish history? Very few historians are here today. How many historians? Raise your hand. Art students. This is an opportunity to raise your hand and be counted. They just did history. History. Those who did history are not raising their hands. You did history? What did history did you do? Pardon? You didn't do history. Okay. So all that he came to do and die on the cross, It's only history students who can, and those who do Jewish history, and those who do the history from AD 1 to whatever, who can know? Huh. I mean, a man from a small religious with only 12 followers who dies on a hill in a corner somewhere outside where they crucify criminals, crucified with thieves. And how will people know about it? Hey! There must be propagators and repeaters of this message. So you can see that before Jesus died on the cross, and after, his last words were, go, go into the world and tell people what has happened here. Yes, tell them, better tell them. Don't have any new fancy ideas. Tell them. Look, no matter your plans, no matter the ideas you have, there will never be anything greater than the gospel of Jesus Christ. I tell you though, I don't care how you want to be rich, how you want to prosper, what you plan to do. I'm telling you that, I mean, unless Jesus is not the Son of God, unless he is not the Son of God. Yes, if he is not the Son of God, then I accept it. But if he is God and the Son of God, then I tell you, it's a very serious thing for us to be quiet on this. Every one of you should be a crusader. Amen. Yes, you should be a crusader. Amen. A soul winner. Amen. Like William Booth said, make yourself saviors of men. Make yourself a savior of men. Yeah. I don't want pastors or bishops who cannot witness and preach the gospel and have people in your churches. On Sunday, I was preaching and I was asking who you got saved when I preached. Then they were standing up all over the place. Kwesi there. Yes, Reverend Kwesi there was stood up. He said, I preached, he gave his life to Christ. Yes, sharp. He was sitting right there. I have all of them. Yes. Huh? Yes. I can point to people. Who can you point to? Who can you point to? You say you are into the prophetic. What is more prophetic than heaven and hell? Something that is coming. Something that is in the destiny. Something that you can see. Many times I preach at the crusade, I tell them that I am a prophet, yes, and that what I am saying will happen. Yes. That they should mark my words, that a day will come, they will die, they will see. That it's either heaven or hell. Which one? You see who is a prophet. You see who is a prophet. Yes. Are you still around? Beautiful. So, I need you to make yourself saviors of men. As a church, UD, we must make the whole church a church that saves people. Listen to the first love messages. Listen to the testimonies. Don't be deceived by people who make you feel that everybody is saved. But it's either you are in this group or in this group. It's not true. They are not saved. Many people are nominal Christian but are not saved. Yes. Today, people who are call themselves Christians and so on, you will not call them even believers. They are not born again. I mean, somebody who goes dancing in a nightclub, we always say the person is not saved. Or if you dance with unbeliever music, I mean, it's unheard of. Unheard of to have a wedding with unbeliever music. I hear A church, is it Church of Pentecost or so? They are banned at no more weddings with unbeliever music. I was even surprised that there's an opportunity to ban something like that. But it shows that the people are not Christians. A Christian will not bring a secular band to come and play at your wedding, or come and serve beer at your wedding, or serve beer at your outdooring. They are not Christians. They are not born again Christians. Oh, come on. The born again Christians don't serve alcohol in their houses. They don't have it. They don't even have it to serve. Huh? No. Engagement, you are taking schnapps, beer, this and that. From the where? Funeral, you are serving beer, you are serving alcohol. We don't serve beer at our Christian funerals. We don't serve beer. Even my father's funeral, I said, I don't have any money to buy beer. And I'm not serving any beer at my father's funeral. From the where? And she'll go and buy whiskey, this, that. I cannot buy it. All these people are not born again Christians. Oh. People who are into lodge and all these things. I mean, all these things, they're all considered as unbelief. They don't mention Christ. They say the great architect of whatever. They are not Christian, Christianity as we know it. Come on. So I'm telling you, you people, stop fooling yourself. Oh, that Ghana is a Christian country. People are, but I mean, fornicating all over the place with whatever, this and that. I mean, those are, they are not Christians. Yeah. Look, I don't know the name of the latest pop singers and so on. But you have Christians, they have all of them as part of that. To us, that's not Christianity. To us, it's not Christianity. And it's like, oh, go and see a prophet, give some money, go and give some money. That is not the Christianity that we know about. They actually need salvation. They actually need to be saved. They don't need to be told to bring an offering. They don't need to be told, bring money and we will pray for you so that you don't die in an accident. That's what we have reduced the gospel to. You bring money. When Ebony died, I read about it. They said, oh, somebody told her that he's going to die, so they should bring, get some money and go and give to the prophet. That is not how, that is not Christianity. That's not how you get saved. It's a completely different thing from how we knew it. Go and give a money to a prophet and then he'll pray for you and then the bad thing will not happen. That is not a Christianity. Gospel is bow your knee to Jesus Christ, surrender all to God and give your life to Christ. One young man, he was hoping that his father was a believer. The father was this everything, all the things they are saying, doing this. So he went to see the pastor. So my father was a Christian. The pastor told him, your father was a wizard. He was not a Christian. He was not a Christian. He was a wizard. Yeah. The young man was shocked. He was shocked. He was expecting, oh, he prayed. He used to do this. He was prayer, this and that. He said, no, he was a wizard. A master of the air. Yes. We are deceiving ourselves that people are saved, though. Because of all this prophetic and have you motivational. It's everybody is like either Christian or not another religion. No. You need repentance. Turning away from sin and coming to God. I hope I'm making myself clear. Yeah. So don't shift from the gospel, because then you go to church. You know, it used to amaze me. You go to a funeral, you see everybody there. People are sad. The priest will come and the way he talks is with the assumption that everyone knows Christ. That's how most of these sermons go. It's like if there's some sort of assumption. So we all need to follow Christ and we all to continue in God and and in times like this, he's our anchor, and so on. That's all. And it's like, we are sitting there, we don't know Jesus, we are not challenged. You know, one day a brother came to me, he said, what? I said, what? He said, I can't believe. You can't believe what? He said, you did an altar call at a wedding. An altar call. I was looking, I said, I don't understand what he said. An altar call at a wedding. An altar call. What? What? I said, altar call. I do altar call every wedding. Every single wedding I do altar call. For 30 years I've been doing altar call at wedding. He said, I can't believe it. Congratulations. Wow. Look, we must come away from the perversions and the variations of the gospel by pastors. Yes, by pastors. Yes, by us who are pastors. Yes, because everything is controlled by the pastors. Yes. And I believe that God will bless us with his presence. Amen. Amen. Now, this gospel being the main thing, are you there? Yes. Is something that is found everywhere. 2 Timothy chapter number 4. This is Paul's last words. The last words of Paul. How do I know it's the last words of Paul? Because he had two books. And his second book has four chapters. And this is his last chapter. And how do I know his last words? As soon as he finished saying these words, he said, I'm ready to die. As soon as he said these words, he says, I'm now ready to die. I want to die now. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Verse 2. Preach! Preach the word. Do what? Preach the word. Yeah. Be instant. In season and out of season. Preach. Reprove. Rebuke. Exhort. With all long suffering. And doctrine. Verse 3. For the time will come. They will not hear, endure sound doctrine, but after their own ears, they shall heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. All right, so they will heap up speakers. And itching ears, you see, itch is where something is worrying you. That's where you want them to press. How many have been itching somewhere? You wanted to touch that place. Yes. Somebody sent me once a gift. The gift was called a good son's back scratcher. For scratching the back. Yes, it's a special device for scratching the back given by a good son. Good son's back scratcher. Where is itching? How to start that So whether it's marriage, that is it. Husband, child, job, visa, the place. Preach about visas. Preach about visas. Business. Huh? Put it back. For the time they will come, they will not endure. Sound drunk, but after their own lusts, they will heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. My wife taught me how to say ears. She told me I was saying it the wrong way. So I've accepted it. So itching ears. Verse 4. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth. It's giving a last word, oh. This is last word, oh. Paul's last word. This last minute word from Paul. They shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. Bring your document and we bless it, and you go and you get the contract. Bring your document. Every kind of preaching is existing today. Fables. This is last minute word from Paul. Watch it. Verse 5. Watch thou in all things. Endure afflictions. This is the last words from Paul. Do the work of an evangelist. Do the work of an evangelist.
Do it. Do it.
Do the work of an evangelist.
Do it.
Eh? Yes. You are a man of God. That's it. Eh? This is the last word. This is the croaky voice. This is the last words. Do the work of an evangelist. Make full proof of thy ministry. Verse 6. It's okay. I want to die now. I don't have anything else to tell you. I'm ready to die. That's it. That's the last word of Paul. I'm ready to die now. As I've told you to do the work of an evangelist, I want to die. With his croaking voice, I'm ready to die now. Those who say you are prophets, you are into the prophetic. Yeah. Apart from church, you have a personal prophet.
Yeah. Say something.
Yes, you have two pastors, one as a whatever, and then a prophet to pray for you over your document, over your passport. Huh? I'm ready to die.
Yeah.
I've told you the most important thing I can ever tell you.
Yes,
I started by saying, preach the word all the time. And finally, do the work of an evangelist. Charlie, I'm out of this world. See you guys later. This is the last and the best thing I can tell you. Charlie, you guys, you for fear last word too. Yes. Where are you going to get members for the churches? Where will you prosper, those of us who want to do business? Let me tell you something. This is the best business. When you do this one, you see how God will say, okay, let me help this guy a bit. Look, prosperity comes from God. If God doesn't prosper you, Obachunia, you will never see the light of day. You bring document every day. You never see. Paul was telling us, keep a sound doctrine. Jude has 25 verses. This is the message of Jude. Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ and brother of James. Verse 1. To them that are sanctified by God. Who wrote this letter? Jude. They are not sure who, whether it was written to Jude or written by Jude. It's the servant of Jesus Christ, brother of James. He's writing to the people that are sanctified. Okay? Let's also see what is his last kalo. 21. It has only 25 verses. Let's start from 21. Keep yourself in the love of God, looking for the mercy of Jesus Christ. Unto eternal life. Verse 22. I'm talking about the last words, last commission. It has only 25 verses. 22. Of some, have compassion, making a difference. Verse 23. Others, save with fear, pulling them out of the fire. Pull people out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh. Last words of Jude, verse 24. Now, it's finished. And to him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. Verse 25. To the only wise God be glory, majesty, dominion, power, both now and forever. Amen. I'm out. As soon as he said, save, look at verse 23. As soon as he said, others, save them with fear, pulling people out of the fire, have compassion, hate even the garments spotted by the flesh. As soon as he said that in verse 23, then he said, verse 24, now. So when the person says, now, and to him is now the blessing finished. It's a prayer. That's the last word. Save with fear people who don't know God. Yes. Salvation and the preaching of the gospel in a church, by a church, through a church, will always be the number one, and anything that leads to it will be always number one, including your business and your education, everything. You see, there always has to be something at the hidden thing. If you take the politicians, you see the hidden thing at the back of all they are doing is for elections. So the decisions you can see, this one is to make you win an election. This one is to make, almost all the decisions you can see is colored by that. So that's why sometimes you look and you wonder whether they are in the same world. They are in the same world. But there is that hidden behind reason that governs all the things that they are doing. And that's why when you are not, whether it's this party or that party, you stand amazed at the things that they do. It defies logic. Yes, if you are not in the river of the politics, you can't even, understand why on earth would people do this when it is so clear that this and this should be done. But it's because behind it all is something that is guiding. And I'm saying that behind it all for the church, do you see what I'm saying? Behind everything that we do should be this overriding purpose of God, that the gospel must be preached. It must be preached. That Jesus must be proclaimed. People must be saved. Jesus is the savior of the world. It must be at the back of everything that we are doing. Yes. And when it is there, you will see, yes, that your decisions will all change. Yes. If you want to be popular, you do certain things. There are some things that make you popular. There are right things to do. Look at the whole country has become a slum. Sodom and Gomorrah slum has reached up to Kwakwe last stop. Those of you who know Accra, has it crossed the road? Yes. Cross up to Kolebu. Four. We may beat Kenya soon with the largest slum. They have the largest. We may soon have the largest. Everybody knows what is right. But if you do, it's not popular. So at the back of it all, we need to win in a short time. So don't do that. It's going to go against our heart's real aim. Our aim is not to care for you or to help or to do what is good. Our aim is to be here and perpetuate our presence. So the overriding thing in your heart, it guides you. Yeah. That's why we are the way we are. So when we change it, we need money. I need you to sow a seed in my life. Bring me cars. Bring me, so that the cars you are sowing as seeds will be parked outside. That I'll preach in a way that everybody, every region will bring me a car. But I know you didn't bring me any car from any region. Look, when this gospel is clear in your heart and your mind, you see, then you are clear. You see, now the owner of 1,000 hills and the cattle on 1,000 hills is now your friend. And he's now going to send into your hand what you could never imagine you would ever have. Yes. Yes. This is a gospel church. God forbid, but in some years to come, the people around could, because in 50 years from now, most of the people here will not be here. I'm sorry to if it shocks you. Yes. Yes. Just 50 years. Who will be here? What will they be saying? What will they be talking about? Huh. It's scary even to think about it. And if in 50 years you have all kinds of things, you wonder what will become of the whole church. And see that the church changes. Then God has to start all over again, raise a new young person, say, my son, I've sent you to the nations. These people, I send them, they have changed so much now, you can't even know what they are talking about when they preach. God forbid. But it's not just by saying God forbid, though. It's by seeing that it's a tendency within us to stray. Thinking that what we need is money, or what we need is influence, or what we need is something else that will not come to us through the gospel. But I'm telling you, it's a gospel church. You cannot say that we are poor. When you come here, you cannot feel that we are poor. Yes. Gospel will bring you everything that you need. Amen. And beyond, you can't use it. You can't use what God will give you. It will be beyond what you need. Trust me. So the gospel, according to Jude, you see that his last words were, Charlie, save people. And that's what he says. Make yourselves saviors of men. Make yourself saviors of men. Amen. Now, let's look at James. the James Commission. James has 5 chapters. And in James chapter 1, he says, chapter 1, verse 1, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. Are you with me?
Yes.
Do you want to know the last commission of James? Are you sure you really want to know?
Yes.
How many chapters? All we have to do is to go and check the last words. James chapter 5. What are his last words? In verse 17. It has only 20 verses. And it says, Elias was a man subject to like passions as we are. And he prayed earnestly that it should not rain. Thank God. And it didn't rain. It rained not on the earth like during Hamatan. By the space of 3 years and 6 months. Can you imagine Ghana without rain for 3 years and 6 months? I wonder what will happen in the country. Huh? 3 years, no rain. Eesh, it will not be easy in Ghana. With our rivers full of mercury, the rivers will be dry. Verse 18. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. It has only 20 verses. Verse 19. Brethren, if any of you do err from the truth, and one convert him, the last commission. Let him know. This is the last thing I want you to know. That he which converted a sinner from the error of his ways shall save a soul from death and shall hide a multitude of sins. Amen. I'm out of here. Bye-bye, world. Bye-bye, world. Bye-bye, Christian world. Yes. Yeah. Let him know. This is the last. Is that verse 21? There's no 21. This is it. This is the last thing. He had. I have nothing else to say about anything anymore. If you save a sinner, you convert a sinner. You have saved a soul from death. And you have hidden a multitude of sins. Whose sins? Your sins also. You don't know why soul winners are blessed. God cannot see their sins. You don't know why soul winners are blessed. God cannot see their mis. God cannot see their errors and their failures. Yeah. You, the soul winner, your sins are covered, and then the sinner too, his sins are also covered. Charlie, because that's what the Bible says. You cover a multitude of sins. That's my last word. And that's Brother James. I have not. Jude was also, what was Jude's last word?
Save them from fire.
Pull them out of this world. And then now to him. And what was Paul's last word? Do the work of an evangelist. I'm out of this world. Bye-bye. I'm ready to die now. Yes. What were Jesus' last words? Go to the world. Preach, 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 preach. I'm with you. Bye-bye. Last words, the last words of Jesus. Amazing. Peter's commission. Are you ready for Peter's commission? Second Peter chapter 3. Second Peter chapter 3. Peter had two books, and his two books, his second book has three chapters. So we have to go to the last chapter to see if he has anything to say last minute. What do you think? Huh? Yeah. Second Peter chapter 3 and verse number 1. This second epistle I now write unto you, both in which I stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance, that you be mindful of the words which were spoken by the holy prophets and by the commandment of the apostles of the Lord and Savior. Knowing this first, that in the last days scoffers shall come, walking after their own lusts, and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. For this they are willingly ignorant, that by the word of God, the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water, all right, whereby the world that then was being overflowed with water perished. Verse 7. But the heavens and the earth, which are now by the same word, are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as one day. Verse 9. There you see the commission. That the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Hallelujah. So right there in this last chapter, you see Peter saying that, look, God does not want anybody to perish. This is the heart of God. Then he, from there onwards, he goes on winding down and then he ends. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise. Verse 11, seeing then that all these shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought you to be in holy conversation and godliness, looking for and hastening unto the coming of the day of God, when the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and new earth, wherein dwell righteousness. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent that ye may be found of him in peace, without spot and blameless. And account that the long suffering of our Lord is salvation, even as our brother Paul also, according to the wisdom given unto him, has written unto you. Amen. Amen. So you see Peter also emphasizing that the Lord is not willing that any should perish,
And that the long suffering of God is our salvation. That is salvation. So the patience of God is pure salvation. That's all. Not pure prosperity. Pure salvation. Pure salvation. So you see, James, Peter, Jude, Paul, everybody at the end starts to emphasize salvation and the preaching of the last words of Jesus Christ, which were, go into all the world and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I want to say to you that preaching about Jesus Christ have brought us this far. And preaching about Jesus Christ will take us all the way to the very end. And if there was ever a need to preach about Jesus Christ, it is now. When Billy Graham died, the world was more full of sinners than when he started preaching. It doesn't mean that he was not effective. But the truth is that the world is getting larger, more evil, and more corrupt. And more people are sinners and need to know the Lord. And so the original message of Jesus Christ and Him crucified will never fade away. It will never reduce or diminish in its importance. It is the main message. And it must be the main motive in our hearts that if we can preach, if we can teach the word, if we can go to the ends of the world, then God will be with us. And when God is with us, you know, everything else works out. Turn to Genesis 39. Genesis chapter 39, verse 1. Genesis 39 and verse number 1. Now Joseph was brought down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, he was brought down as a slave, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, bought him out of the hands of the Ishmaelites, which had brought him down hither. So now, bondage, difficulties begin for Joseph. He had never experienced such a thing before. Now, how many have been in difficulty before? Yes. Sometimes the beginning of difficulty is you don't even know what is coming. You think it's hard. But verse 2. Now the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man. The Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man. So when God is with you, you see, when he says, lo, I am with you, go and preach this gospel. Lo, I am with you. You don't know what it means. This is it. The Lord, Genesis 39, verse 2. The Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man. Prosperity is connected to the presence of God. Now look at verse 3. And his master saw. You see, even his master saw that the Lord was with him. The master, the unbeliever master, he saw that the Lord was with him and that the Lord had made all that he did to prosper in his hand. So prosperity is from the presence of God in your life. That's what I believe. So why should I give myself to seeking prosperity, but rather I should give myself to seeking the presence of God and whatever will let the presence of God be in my life. That's what I should do. And that's what you should do. Yes. I have prospered far more following God than trying to follow things. Far. far. And I've watched people following things, following this, following that. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. All the things that people are dying for, killing themselves for, fighting over, shall be added unto you. So today, I am sharing with you the Great Commission. I want the Great Commission, make yourselves saviors of men. It's just another way, nice way of saying the Great Commission. Make yourselves saviors of men, to be the commission of everyone. Now, you see, it's amazing. You would think that a bishop will by all means have it as his main commission. It's not true. There's nothing more far from the truth than that. A person can be a bishop of, he can be whatever. There is nothing about him that saves anybody. Yes. Yeah. A pastor can be reverend, whatnot, but you see that he's far from making himself saviors of men. Yeah. Now, even amongst my bishops, I know some of them are more of saviors of men. Others are just preaching. Amongst the bishops, we have 77 bishops. So it's quite a number of them. I know some of them are more like, if somebody falls into your square, he will be saved. Some of them, they're just around. They're like Orthodox priests, just singing and just moving around. Like, God forbid. Yeah. It's true. You know, one day I went to preach at one of our programs on a campus. And a little young girl spoke to me after. She asked me, "Daddy, are you okay?" I said, "I'm okay." She said, "Today when you were preaching, I wasn't afraid." I said, "Usually when we are preaching gospel, I become afraid." I was surprised that she noticed, because I wasn't myself that day. But she came and said, are you okay?" I said, "But usually when my heart beats." Yes. Many of you don't preach your heart, anybody's heart will beat. Nice guys. You know, it offends me, because if I had died, I would have gone to hell and I was sitting in the church, and they would not tell me about Jesus. I just assumed that I was a Christian. I just say Hail Mary, say Our Father, say this and that. It hurt me. What about if you go to hell? And I almost died, you know, in that period. Something happened. I almost died in the beach. I almost drowned. The wave was from here to the top of this place. I was under in the water. Yeah. And Jesus saved me that day. Yes. It's like the Sea of Galilee. You think it's calm. Every year, so many people drown in the Sea of Galilee. Yes. Every year, so many people drown in the Sea of Galilee. You see, calm. At least 5 people every year. And sometimes more. Onale, calm. No, Israelis, different people. Yeah. Some guy just went swimming. He just went from here to here. And they were watching him, and he dived, and after that, they didn't see him again. And then there are some currents. Yes. I was in the water like that. I tell you, the water was up to here. When they say tsunami, it was up like that. And I was under. I was under like that. I swam and swam and swam, so I wasn't coming out. I would have died. I would have died going to hell, screaming. I've stuck before priest after priest, sitting there just talking on with assumption that you are saved. Now, I wasn't saved. I wasn't saved at all. It offends me. It hurts me as I see that type of Christianity where we are silent about salvation. Yes. Where we are not passionate about salvation. And where we are just coaxing people along and want people to be in the church. It offends me. Yeah. You know, I like real things. Yes. A lot of prayer meetings, the people have come to pray. You see a lot of churches full of prayer meetings, people want something from God. It's not that they, it's that they're coming to bind the landlord, or they're coming to curse something or break something to get something out of God. So you see this type of 21 days fasting where people are coming back. It's not really seeking God. Yes. Is it true or it's not true? Raise your hand if it's true. Yeah. If you don't keep rebuking yourself, you go far astray. Yes. And instead of being happy with certain people as church members, you say, these people are wizards. They are pure wizards. So, salvation must become the main thing. And I believe it will lead to prosperity. Yes. Yes. Prosperity is not the main thing. The main thing is Jesus. And salvation. The main thing is not business. It's not motivation. Motivational speaking. It's Christ. Yes. And then, Lord, I will be with you. I will bless you and I'll prosper you. So, all that we would say during these meetings from tomorrow and onwards, this is an opening night. All that we will say, you need to have this one in your anchor. You need to anchor yourself. Even if I preach to you about leadership or anything, any topic, or even finance, anything, you need to have this one in your heart. You need to, I'll tell you something. If you are in this church, you need to support Healing Jesus Crusade. No, more than other. There are many things to support. Let's say church building, buy a piano, buy speakers, orphanage, children's school, beggars, everything. Like, salvation should be the priority of your life. Then I think you are a real Christian. I'm not telling you not to support this, but I'm saying that, like, when you weigh your options, you get what I'm saying? Like, your main thing should be salvation of people. Yes. Salvation of people. Yes. Not anything else. Let us focus on the main thing that God is giving to us. I know that God is going to bless us. He says, and the Lord was with Joseph, and the Lord prospered him. Yes. So when God is with you, he will prosper you. Amen. I mean, are we preaching? If we are poor, how can we be standing here? It's not possible. It's the opposite. Yeah. And we are still carrying on. So, brothers and sisters, I want this one to lock your heart. Yes. Don't be a businessman who's not a soul winner. Okay, business. Any business you are doing, be a soul winner. Yes, be a soul winner. Did you hear me? Be a soul winner. Saviors of men. Make yourself a savior of men, businessman. Yeah. Make yourself a savior of men. Somebody, a student, savior. Any work you do, anything you do, make yourself a winner, a savior of men. Pure salvation. And I'll tell you, when you can't lead somebody to Christ, it shows that there's something wrong with you. Yes. When somebody can't give birth, there's something wrong. Either this or this or this or this or that or something, but there's something wrong. We all know that. That's why you go to the hospital. You don't just go. You don't just not go. You go to the hospital. Oh, there's something is wrong. What is the wrong thing? And sometimes it's so mysterious to find, but there's something wrong. That's why we can't lead people to God. It's because there's something wrong. So everyone here must decide, I am a soul winner. No matter what I'm doing, that is the priority of my life. And when is the priority of your life? Everything else will fall into place. Amen. Everything else will fall into place. God will answer your prayers. Amen. God will bless you. Amen. God will help you. Amen. God will remember you. Amen. God will deliver you. Amen. God will save you. Amen. God will give you long life. Amen. All the things you pray for, you stop praying for them.
You just be praying for souls and praying for the work of God. And you see that the things will be added unto you. They will be coming and coming and coming and coming and coming and coming. In the mighty name of Jesus. Stand to your feet, everybody. Lift your hands and ask God to make you be a lasting soul winner for the rest of your life. 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 I want to be a soul winner. 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 Manta sano kapala mashanda. A soul winning bishop. A soul winning businessman. A soul winning reverend minister. A soul winning pastor. A soul winner. 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 Pashando laba.
Sandiri moshki brahataya. Vrando kabari moshki bahandi. Zibabaka falita halita. Ha kukusibaka finibato. Zibranita rakabalita. Shibako barima hatifandi. Lino kabalimo kafita. Zumblindi zibraka tumriki handi. Ha rakandu zibrani. Rakatati mohabi. Zikumba handita. Brundi zibraka faya. Because so winners, Lord. Saviors of men, Lord. Rakabahani katombalida. Masita fani. Rakima hankubalita. Malis kubranita ta. Halita kandi bahani. Li kakusi. Zibababa raka Lironso rikifa Rikikoba Bito kibali zita Zubrakandi tata Lubrandi hikobahati Shkibahanda bati Zibaku zikabakiva Frekutu, frekutu, frekutu Brikihamba litota Limus kibaha Bali frakita, frakita, frakita Brakundi kahani Zibruka fribatute Hayeka bati, hayeka bati Raka dikandusi Zini Kimba handi, rakakambalita tata, breku fumblede, bledi tumblanita banda, breka bata, breka bata, rakikoba, breki kumbalita kandi, zumbriku kumbahandita, bitu roka bani, ratatati kaba, balita handika moskika, hei takani, zika bahandita, Jesus, 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 yes, Jesus, oh God, whatever we do, there will be so witness, Lord. Whatever we do, oh God, there will be so witness, Lord. There will be so witness, Lord. Whatever we do, Lord. Rabba baba bandiri batakani. Balito roma kabalitakani. Zibatata. 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 Rakababa bandiri batataya. Broke baba.
Mande kamamba. Sombore na melede.
Ha mahaya. Yaitanita. Yaitanita.
Yaitanita.
Zikabata, Rakababa, let me show in this, Lord. Oh God, give us mercy, Lord. Show witness, Lord. Show witness, Lord. Show witness, Lord. Be nothing more important to us that we are no souls. Be nothing more important to us that we are no souls. Oh God, oh God, whatever we do, wherever we are, whatever state we find ourselves, let us show witness, Lord. Show witness, Lord. Show witness, Lord. Show witness, Lord. Every one of us, oh God, we pray. We pray, oh God. We pray, oh God. We pray, oh God. Propagators of the gospel, preachers, Lord, have mercy, Lord.
Mando kabara mara shandele beke mara maba.
Oh Jesus.
Oh
Jesus.
Oh Jesus. We pray,
we pray, O God. Deliver us, O God. Deliver us, O God. May we not move away, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Lift your hands. Father, I pray for everybody here that the grace for soul winning, something that needs faith. Lord, because we can't see heaven, we can't see hell, but we can see your word. I pray that the grace for soul winning and for making ourselves saviors of men will be on every person here. Lord, from now till we die. Not from now for just, you know, like a few weeks or this year. But Lord, from now till we die, let the grace of soul winning be on everyone. Receive it now. Receive it now. Receive it now. In Jesus' name. Give the Lord a mighty clap offering. You may be seated. Now, I know that many of us here are soul winners already. But it is important for me to preach what I'm preaching. Because a time will come, people will not listen to sound preaching. Amen. And it is important that we repeat the Great Commission over and over. So, no matter what else we do, we are doing that. And we are going to be doing that. Obadiah, verse 21, says, saviors shall come up on Mount Zion to judge Mount Esau. All right? And the kingdom shall be the Lord's. Saviors shall come up. Now, most people quote Obadiah 17. Most people love Obadiah 17. Which is, but upon Mount Zion shall be deliverance, and there shall be holiness, and the house of Jacob shall possess their possessions. Yes. Most people love Obadiah 17 because Obadiah 17 is on Mount Zion. We have come to Zion. You see. And in Mount Zion there shall be deliverance. So that we'll be delivered from the devil. And then there shall be holiness, which means to be special before God. And then the house of Jacob shall possess cars, houses, and all these things. They are possessions. They shall possess their possessions. Okay? But after you have possessed your possessions, in chapter verse 17, verse 18 says, the house of Jacob shall be a fire, Joseph a flame, Esau for stubble, it shall kindle them, devour. There shall not be any remaining of the house of Esau, for the Lord has spoken it. Verse 19, and the south shall possess the mount of Esau, and they of the plain of the Philistines, they shall possess the fields of Ephraim. A lot of things, possessions. Verse 20, and the captivity of this host of the children of Israel shall possess that of the Canaanites, and the captivity of Jerusalem, which is in Shephard, shall possess the cities of the south. A lot of possessions. But then in verse 21, it says, and saviors shall come upon Mount Zion. So after possessing your possessions, you are supposed to become a savior of men. Amen. Amen. And they shall come to judge the Mount of Esau, and the kingdom shall be the Lord's. Amen. Amen. So I release you as saviors of men. And I'm sending you as saviors of men. Yes. To do the work of a savior. What did he say? Some save with fear. Isn't it? Out of the fire. Save them. Pull them out of the fire. God is going to use us for that. Yes. Trust me. You know, when you have a pure heart and that pure motive is in you, you will see that. It purifies everything you are doing and makes you go further. God can bless you. Amen. You know, you can be a doctor, but you just want money. So somebody who doesn't need an operation, you operate. You see, somebody who could have delivered normally, you do an operation. And so many things, you change all because it's money you want. So it changes what you are doing. You can be a lawyer. All you want money. You know that the person you are defending is a thief. You go and say, he's not a thief. Your Honor, I say he's not a thief. And you collect money from the guy. But it's like, when your motive is pure, you get it? It purifies the work that you are doing. So I want your motive to be pure. Only one motive. To win souls, to do what he said. His last words, his last commission, his great words. Amen. And God will be with you in a very special way. Yes, he will bless you. Hallelujah. What you never thought you would see. You see it again and again and again. You know, when Kenneth Hagin had a winter Bible seminar, the first night always he just started on Sunday, he would always preach something about hell or salvation. Yeah, I heard amazing stories when he preached on Sunday. He said, a lot of people haven't come, so he's going to talk about whatever. That was always what he talked about, salvation. He used to make a banner. He said, come and listen to the man who has been to hell and came back. Yeah. He said to somebody said, I don't need to read the Bible to know about hell. I was there. I went there. I came back. I don't need to read the Bible to know about hell. I know everything. I said, wailing, weeping, gnashing of teeth. I don't need to read the Bible to know about that. I was there. Yeah. And I came back. Amen. It's amazing. So when you do that, you will last. Yes, you'll be there later when others have vanished, you'll still be around. Amen. God will be using you. Amen. Because it's the only reason that we are here. We are not looking for jobs, we are looking for Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. So, Obadiah 21, please check it out. Obadiah 21, saviors shall come to Mount Zion to judge the Mount of Esau, and the kingdom shall be the Lord's. Amen. Amen. Let us take out an offering. Let us take out an offering, and we are going to give our very first and good offering to bless the Lord. Amen. Now, hallelujah. Now, God is going to bless you as you give. All right? So have soul winning at the back of your mind as you are giving. Now, do you know what this campus is for? You know, a man came to see me, a very important man, and he spoke to me. He said, I was there. I saw all that you have done there. This has to be a university with the leadership teachings of Doug Heward Mills. It must be a university. It cannot go waste. You know. I think I was a great disappointment to him. I told him, I'm sorry. I have no interest. This place is a church. It's a church. The one who would change it, you should know, you and your family and the descendants, let them be accursed. You are cursed. The meeting that you have to change that thing, they meet all the people will be cursed. Yes. Plus that person also. In case you are here after 50 years, and it's written there. This is a church. Yes. It's not a business. And it's not an institute of anything. It's a school for we, all the people, we are raising missionaries to go into the world. If you don't like certain things, I think you are in the wrong church. The church is the wrong church for you. We have so many churches. You have to join a new one. But some by the roadside. Yeah. This gentleman says that they've seen some churches by the roadside there. So they should see you after church. Stand up. They should see you after church to show them the way to any of those churches. He's available to show you the direction to any other church. All right. So I all the offering that we are going to give is going to help the school to propagate the gospel and train the people. It's making saviors of men. It involves a lot to be here. Yes. So many things. I don't want to bother you. So I want you to have that in mind as you are giving. It's to help to be, as to be saviors of men. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Lift your offering up and let me pray. Father in heaven, thanks a million for the first day of Harmattan Bible Seminar 2019. What a blessing. Make us saviors of men by this offering. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Ashes, please receive the offering. Let's welcome Ida.
Oh Lord Jesus, I am a sinner, please forgive me. I've done many wrong things. Please wash away my sins in the blood of Jesus. As I bow before your throne and I kneel before your cross, your mercy is what I need. Please have mercy on me. I'm turning from my past. Lord, show me your grace. Jesus, I want to thank you for my salvation, for making room for me. I want to live my life saying thank you for my salvation. I am am in your hands. You found me in a mess. You washed me white as snow. Give me this salvation, my salvation. Oh, oh, oh. Jesus, thank you for my salvation. Oh, 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 Jesus, thank you for my salvation. Oh, 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 Lord Jesus, I open my heart to you. I know you are knocking at the door of my heart. You want to come in. Please come into my heart right now. Please come in and sup with me. Take over my life. Please change my life forever. Oh, Jesus, I want to thank you for my salvation, for making room for me. I want to live my life saying thank you for my salvation. I am in your hands, Lord. You found me in a mess. You washed me white as snow. Gave me the salvation, my salvation. Oh, oh, oh. Jesus, thank you for my salvation. Oh, 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 Jesus, thank you for my salvation. Oh, Lord Jesus, you know my name is Ida. Please write this name in the book of life. Oh, today I belong. Salvation, for making room for me. I wanna live my life saying thank you for my salvation. Lord, I am in your hands. Oh, you found me in a mess. You washed me white as snow. Give me the salvation, my salvation. Salvation, for making room for me. I wanna live my life saying thank you for my salvation. I am in your hands, Lord. You found me in a mess. You washed me white as snow. Gave me the salvation, my salvation. Oh, my salvation, I want to thank you, Lord Jesus. Oh, thank you for my salvation. Oh, 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 Jesus, I want to thank you for my salvation. saved me. He saved us for all time. What about others? He saved you and he saved me. What are we doing? Oh, for others. Do you believe in dreams? The Holy Spirit's dreams. Thousands of men running down the streets. Oh yeah. They didn't know that the road was leading to a steep and deadly cliff and down into the fire. Whoa, whoa. He saved you, he saved me. Oh yeah, he saved us for all time. What about others? Oh, oh yeah, he saved you and he saved me. But what are we doing? Oh, for others. Multitudes, multitudes. Multitudes are waiting in the valley of decision. Oh yeah, they're waiting, they're hoping to hear the gospel. They don't know Jesus Christ, they are lost and dying souls. He saved you, he saved me. He saved us for all time. What about others? Oh, yeah. He saved you and he saved me. But what are we doing? Oh, oh, for others. Why do we sit and wait while millions go to hell? Their blood is on our hands. It's time to preach the word. Oh, the gospel of Jesus in its pure and simple form is what is missing now in the church. What are we preaching? Oh, he saved you. Saved us for all time. But what about others? Whoa. He saved you, he saved me. Oh yeah. But what are we doing for others? We are the salt of the world, the light of the world. Are we really shining? Shining like we should. We are the salt of the world and the light of the world. Are we really shining as the light of the world? He saved you, he saved me. Oh yeah, he saved us for all time. But what about others? What about others? He saved you and he saved me. Oh yeah. But what are we doing? What are we doing for others? Tell me, what are we doing for the others? sit on a lonely bench by the fields of heaven. I'll sit and think about my life, the life I lived, the things I did, the places I went. I hope I never say I regret.
I wanna go back.
missionaries must enter with all their heart into the spirit of the mission. Encounter the hardships of the mission. Oh, on the mission field. An uncomfortable manner of living. And every other inconvenience. A bit of clothing, a few essentials. Ready to work as a farmer or a fisherman. This is how to be a missionary. Oh, this is how to serve the Lord. Do you be a missionary? Oh, why are you not a missionary? You too can be a missionary.
Mm-hmm.
Let's take a walk together with our Savior Jesus, hand in hand, he and I. Let's cherish every moment Jesus gives to us. The time is passing by. I often pray when I kneel down by my bedside. I ask the Lord to help me to obey his calling. If I could just please the Lord, I must cherish the love of God. I must cherish the grace of God. Oh, cherish his mercies, cherish his blood, cherish the cross of Christ. I must cherish the chance I have. I must cherish the lost in darkness, no one seeks for God, but Jesus died to save the world. So many lost and dying, they never heard of Jesus. Can I help to tell them? Whoa. I often pray when I kneel down by my bedside. I ask the Lord to help me to obey his calling. If I could just please the Lord, I must cherish the love of God. I must cherish the grace of God. Oh, cherish his mercies, cherish his blood, cherish the cross of Christ. I must cherish the chance I have, and I must cherish the call of God. Oh, cherish the time I have to work, cherish these times of grace. From your original calling, your time is passing by. So when you pray, when you kneel down by your bedside, please ask the Lord to help you to obey his calling. If you could just please the Lord, cherish the grace of God, oh yeah, cherish his mercies and cherish his blood, oh, cherish the cross of Christ. You must cherish the chance you have, you must cherish the call of God, oh, cherish the chance you have to work, cherish these times of grace. Ooh.
Why don't you clap your hands for the Lord? Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. Wow. I believe that this is such an amazing time. Isn't it? Wow. I've always known that a Savior's last words was go and teach. I didn't know that Paul's last words was also that we must do the works. Peter's last words, all of them, as they were ending their lives, they left out the message. Hallelujah. Well, I believe that.
Person is giving, the first person has done well, second has done well, we are leading, third has done well, we are leading, then the last man has dropped the baton, but he's still leading, the rest are far behind, and he has a chance to pick up the baton and continue the race. We'll be screaming, pick it up and go. I think this is what God has given to us tonight. We are picking up the baton and we are going to run faster. God bless you, Bishop, for always keeping these words on your heart. Never shifting from them. Never going away from them. When I met you in 1981, it was your heart. And it has still been your heart, your emphasis. You've never shifted from it. Maybe some silently you were avoiding the curse of Paul so that you don't shift the gospel to another gospel. God has blessed you to maintain this call for us. And we are going to run with it. Thank you very much. Tomorrow morning we are back here at 8 a.m. Is it a good plan? Please be seated for a few seconds. I think it's a good plan. We come here tomorrow. It's a camp meeting. And you need to have that mind and focus so that you can be blessed throughout. All right. Now, during the sessions, I believe tomorrow morning we'll be emphasizing it, but during the sessions, you are not allowed to be walking around. This is a holy ground. Instead of removing your sandals, just stay in one place. This is holy ground. It's not saying remove your sandals, but stay in one place. If you feel like wee-weeing, there will always be a time to wee-wee, and you should wait till the session is over, then you can wee-wee comfortably. If you have to do number two, unless it's an emergency, just stay right there. We are all grown-ups. We are able to keep it for a long time. Is that not so? Beautiful. So please make sure and be your brother's keeper. Don't allow people to disturb you. Sometimes in a certain moment of the session, then somebody just gets up. You don't even know where he's going. Just going to Okojin Frama, just going outside to just catch some air. It's not appropriate. So please, let's respect the presence of God so that he can bless us in a maximum way. And then we are closing tonight. I think this is probably the first time we are allowing ourselves to go down the hill, go back to Accra and return for sessions like this. So please, drivers of these buses, do not drive fast. We are not trying to fulfill any race or any Formula One. There's no prize being given to the first to arrive in Medina or the first to get to Shiashi. There's nothing like that. And if you're a young man and you've just got a car, please listen to us. Don't drive fast. There's no point. You will still get to where you are going. We need to go safely and return safely so that God can bless us. Thank you very much. Please stand to your feet. Let's allow Bishop to please leave. Clap your hands. Okay. Now, there'll be t-shirts. There are t-shirts being sold around. You need to get one so that on the appropriate day, I think it will be Friday. Friday will be t-shirt day. So everybody must get one. I'm sure there's enough for all of us. So please buy one. Don't use all for food. Okay. And then also, those going to the orphanage, there's no rush. Breathe in the air here, okay? And don't rush onto the buses like, I have to get there first. Remember, there's no prize for the one who gets to the orphanage first or to wherever you are going first. So please make sure that you relax. Be a Christian. Don't rush. We like rushing for things. Rushing to go and sit in the bus. Before you realize, you are sitting in the bus that's going to Nsawam. And if you make a mistake of falling asleep before they get to the orphanage, then you wake up only to find out that you are around Brikuso. Then you ask, where are we going? And so we are going to Nsawam. So I'm at the orphanage. You rushed for nothing. So relax. If the bus is full, just hang around. The buses will return, pick you comfortably. All will be done decently and in order. Don't fight. If you push somebody off the bus, Satan has filled your heart. Hold your neighbor's hand. Tell him, brother, I'm a soul winner. Be a soul winner. I'm a soul winner. Be a soul winner. Tell them we must become saviors of men. My mind is changing. My heart is changing. And my heart will be fixed on the right thing, the salvation of man. Share the grace with your neighbor, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion, fellowship, contribution, participation, and the sweet influences of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you.